Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council meeting for Tuesday, May 20th, 2014. This evening we will begin in honor of Ida June Baker, born April 24th, 2014, to Courtney and Josh Baker. And I would like to note that Ida is the granddaughter and named for a former employee of our city, Ida Smith. So we'd like to welcome Ida to Monrovia and open in her honor this evening. Our invocation will be given to us by Reverend Neil Tadkin and the Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Tom Adams.
Source of life and giver of grace, we ask for the spirit of wisdom, justice, and charity to guide all our work here this evening. We guide us, the people of Monrovia, and our officials and representatives to faithful administration, wise laws, that the rights of all may be protected and our community enabled to fulfill the purpose of abundant life for all. And we ask this in the name of all that we know as holy. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have roll call, please?
Councilmember Adams.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin.
Here.
Mayor Lutz.
Present.
And Councilmember Blackburn and Spicer are not in attendance tonight.
Thank you. First, we will have a report from our closed session. Mr. Steele.
Thank you, Mayor. Prior to the meeting this evening, the council met in closed session, as well as the successor agency to the redevelopment agency met in closed session regarding the three items on the posted agenda. Council members Blackburn and Spicer were absent. The council slash successor agency board took no reportable action.
Thank you. Our student liaison is not with us this evening. We will now go to the order of the business, and at this time, I would like to introduce to the community our acting city manager, Mr. Steve Sizemore.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I appreciate it. There's two items for the order of business, change of order of the business. We will be pulling item CC10. From the consent calendar, and also item CC12 from the consent calendar. Item CC12, no action will be taken, and both those will follow immediately following the consent portion of the agenda.
Great, thank you very much. So at this time, we will take up the consent calendar, which will be items 1 through 9 and 11.
I'll move approval.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. That passes. And now, because we have such a short agenda, we're going to take up our item CC10. I do have a speaker card on that. So do we want to give a quick report on it, and then we'll have the speaker speak?
Yes, we can do that. Carl, if you don't mind.
I'll mark
that.
Briefly, this is the engineering report that goes along with the lighting and landscape assessment district. Every year prior to the levy of the tax for the assessment district, there's an engineer's report that is done that basically looks over the layout of the city and determines if there's any changes in terms of how they calculate the assessments for all of the properties. So every year there is an engineering report that is done. We contract that with MBS. They do the report, and they calculate what the budget. We give them the budget of what the cost of the different pieces of the operating costs for the lighting landscape assessment district. There are structures of rates and fees that can be charged for this district. It cannot be increased without a vote of the people. And so this engineering report sets the stage for a public hearing that is done in June, and at that time the rates are then set for the next fiscal year's budget, and it's for the a tax assessment that goes on the next year's, on the 14-15 property tax rolls. There is no increase in this lighting landscape assessment district because there is no increase that can be done without a vote of the people.
Thank you very much.
That was a short report, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Does anybody from council have any comments? Okay, then I'll bring up our speaker on this, which is Gwendolyn Jones.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Gwendolyn Jones, your neighbor from Monrovia. And to our mayor and to all the city council that's here and all the others that are in leadership today. I've looked at CC10 and I've separated lighting from landscape. And I'm hoping that landscape is actually the maintenance, the physical landscape that's not associated with the lights. Because two streets in Monrovia come to mind. Cypress between Shamrock and Myrtle. There's a portion of Cypress Street that is a city property, and for a whole year it's just not been maintained very well. I passed it on the way here. It's full of weeds and everything else, and it's owned by the city of Monrovia, and it's between Shamrock and Myrtle. It's city property. On the corner, there have been some sandbags there a year and a half with a little piece of plywood. I don't know what that means. And also on Maple, the city property is not maintained. It looks bad. And the mediums between Shamrock and Myrtle, they're in poor shape as well. So I'm thinking that if people live on those streets, they might want a little money back from the taxes that they're getting because they're not getting representation. And that is part of Monrovia, and we're one Monrovia. And so I'm hoping that can be looked at. And there are other patches as well. But those two stand out because those plots and pieces of land on those streets, they're residential properties that have to look direct at a block wall that's got foliage on it and a lot of weeds and a lot of undercare. Thank you for the space.
Thank you. Mr. Sizemore, can we have somebody take a look at both of those locations? And
yes, we'll do that.
Great. Thank you very much. If there are no other questions from council or staff, we will entertain a motion.
I'll move we adopt Resolution 2014-22 and 2014-23, recognizing that this is just setting for public hearing, and we'll probably have more comments at that time.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. This does pass. And now, as Mr. Sizemore stated, CC-12 will not be moved upon this evening, but we do have several speakers who would like to speak on the item. So we will go ahead and take your comments this evening, and this item will be brought up at our next council meeting. The speakers I have are Ray Morford.
I think we can vote on this evening, unless I misunderstood you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council.
Can I ask you to hold one quick second, Ray,
sure,
while we clear up the agenda item?
You can vote on whatever you want, but the question I was asked was whether it could be continued.
Right. Thank you.
Go ahead.
You're ready. Okay. I've lived in this city since 1967. Our first house we bought, I've lived there ever since. My kids have grown up there. We've gone to school here. and I'm thinking of the quality of life we have here in Monrovia. When we first moved here, Huntington Drive was the pits. I used to go get off at midnight from the police department in Pasadena and drive down towards California Avenue, and there was a liquor store on the corner. I was still in uniform, so the chief, who was then a lieutenant, would wave at me. He knew me because we went to church together. He said, "Can you come over and help me with this skirmish line?" And we would move everybody out of the parking lot because they were ready to have a fight. The buildings there weren't worth a whole lot. Redevelopment took over, and we have changed that whole area of Monrovia because we did it our way. We had to abide by certain rules and regulations here in the because of the state mandate. But redevelopment changed Monrovia for the better. Secondly, I look around at Old Town and see how hard working the merchants are there to make things proper and good for us here in the city. I look at Huntington Oaks. The other night, my wife and I went out to eat. We couldn't find a place to park in near one of the restaurants. There were so many people. It's the quality of life. Now, there was a report back some time ago said that Monrovia was the best city in San Gabriel Valley inviting business into it. I think that is outstanding. You look at our churches that are working in the community, working with the Boys and Girls Club, working with families that have lost loved ones through tragic death. You look on before Christmas, we have the Sing in the Library Park. This is quality of life. I've also started checking the streets for the last 2 months, driving up and down the streets. Since I'm retired, I can take the liberty and do that. I haven't seen one little plastic bag in the street. Now, I did have somebody that didn't live in the city ahead of me pulled out one of these fast food restaurants, I watched them, pulled their sandwich out of the bag and threw the bag into the street. They drove on out of the city. I'm looking up and down the streets here in the hillside, in every area of this city, and I don't see plastic bags on the street. I think it's silly for us to get involved. I also got an email from our representative in Sacramento, Holden. He says he's against the state mandate banning plastic bags. Now, that's a good sign. I don't think we have to look like Pasadena or Arcadia or Duarte or San Gabriel Valley or down here in the county area. We need to be individualized here in this city. And we have accomplished all of that because we've done it the Monrovia way. Our schools are better than they used to be. I remember Bruce Brady, when he was on the school board here years ago, I worked with him at that time. Before I was on the police department, I was managing the credit union for the classified employees in Los Angeles. And Bruce would come over and say, "We got to work on these schools. We got to do a better job." He worked hard, and we got the Board of Education building here now. There is a lot of improvement in this area. I'm not saying we're perfect, but for us to mess around with a stupid little plastic bag is ridiculous. I was embarrassed the last board meeting. I watched it on TV when all this train of people from outside the city came in and talked about our hillside. It's ridiculous. We do it our way, not because we're trying to fit in with a federal agenda or anything else. Now, I do agree that we must be involved with the cities of San Gabriel Valley. We must be involved with the goal line because it's going to affect our city. But to get involved in a national agenda is ridiculous. And because other cities are jumping on the bandwagon and saying that little bag's a problem is really stupid. I'm interested in doing it the Monrovia way, and I'm asking you to do the same thing. I've been around and talked to merchants, and they are upset. If that happens, they're going to go someplace else. It's going to destroy our way of life here in Monrovia. I want to keep it the same way. Some of it's simple. I enjoy it. I live on Valmont Drive, and how many years in a row have we won the best decorated city, best decorated street in the city at Christmas time? It's because we pulled together and did it. And I am urging our board of directors to put their thinking caps on, and how is this going to affect our merchants and individuals that live in this city? Thank you.
Thank you. Gina Mills.
Good evening, my city council and my city mayor. I'm Gina Mills, 11-year resident of Monrovia. I live on East Walnut, and I'm before you today as a citizen. I'm here tonight because I have 114.4 reasons to respond as opposing item C-12, also known as the regulating the use of plastic carryout bags and recyclable bags, promoting the use of reusable bags. Now, please, don't worry. I won't cover all 114 reasons, but I would like to cover a couple of points, and I want to cover those points from perspective for which you may not have heard of at this time. So the number 114 is important. You see, I shop at Pavilions, and I do so multiple times in the week. I'm a working mom who's on the go. I have a household of four people that I have to support. And when I'm going to the store these multiple times in a week, my shopping sessions will yield about 22 bags. I know so because I actually counted last night. Now, with this ordinance and any other legislations that might come down, as I understand it, large corporations like Pavilions, their mother companies, will be encouraged and will be supported by our government to support a charge, a minimum of 10 cents per brown bag. Now, this is the same brown bag that I get today for free. In actuality, the price of this bag is already built into the food model for where I already purchased my food. Now, when I do the math, and I have, 22 bags, and if I go to the store once a week all year, when I do the math, that's $2.20 a week. And over a year time, that's $114, okay? I did the math. Now, this is a regressive tax. That's what I truly think. Now, the stores can call them in. The bigger corporations can call it anything that you want, but it is a regressive tax because let me tell you, this $115 will go to Pavilion, or I'm not going to call it Pavilion, but larger companies, stakeholders, and some will venture to say it will end up in a re-education fund to retrain those who have lost their jobs as a result of plastic bag bans. I don't trust that because money disappears. I work on budgets all the time. They somehow magically disappear. The purpose of a corporation is to make money and to do what is in its best interest to do. And sometimes that may not be in my best interest. You see, that $114, it belongs to me. The amount that they're charging me for that bag, it belongs to me. And what am I spending it on? I'm spending it on my light bill. I'm spending it on my gas bill. I'm spending on the transportation fees that I have to get back and forth to work. I'm even putting it in a little fund to go take my kid out to Disneyland for her birthday, which that cost has actually increased since 2003. So that money does mean something. It's out of my pocket. So if they're thinking about charging funds, it's on my back. Now, I have a middle income. That's the kind of family we have. And so, like I said, for some, this may not be a large amount, but for me, it is. I'm also facing, as a mom and COO of my family, rising food prices. Did you know that since the beginning of this year, four tenths of a percent we've actually had increase in our food budgets? So for me, if I look and do the math again, by the end of the year, I have now an increase of $20. And so if I add that on to the 114, it starts to add up, and it's not money that I am in control of any longer. So I say, what is this? Is this a redistribution of wealth? If it is, then I'm on the losing side of it. And I don't think that is right. Now, just like I said, like the larger corporations, I have to watch my bottom line because every cent matters. So I will go to other stores if I have to. I have already started to do that. When I go to Pasadena and I don't have my reusable bag, I actually will wait until I come back home to Monrovia or Arcadia or if I'm over at Target, and I will purchase my goods there. So as we push this here, then I may have to unanchor myself from this place and start to look elsewhere. And it sounds like I'm probably not in the minority of that. So the other thing is, I'm beginning to believe that environmentalism has been hijacked by the marketing gurus. You know, I've examined the campaigns that support the county and state bans. And just by me getting up here and saying that I'm against a ban, some folks may be thinking at home and even here, I'm anti-environment. Just because I'm not in favor of a 10-cent charge on bags or thicker reusable bags doesn't mean I'm not in favor of recycling and seeking improvements for our environment. Nothing could be further from the truth. I'm just not going to go and jump on any of the hype that's there. So what I do recommend is we enforce the laws we already have on the books and raise awareness on our existing recycling plans. You see, I'm part of that 1% that does recycle and reuse, and I teach my kids to do the same. You know, they recycle their bags and their bottles. In fact, for the 22 bags that I mentioned earlier, they're not single use in my household. I use them in our household for our animal waste, our diaper waste, and believe it or not, I even believe in returning the bags that we don't use back to the store so it can be placed in the recycling bin for further repurposing. Perhaps many people don't pay attention to this, but consumers are already encouraged to return their bags to the store. It even says so on the plastic bags. See, it says, reuse and recycle. Help protect our environment. Please bring this bag to your local pavilions for recycling. I wonder how many of our people here and at home have actually noticed that on our bag, and actually know that if you go to our friendly pavilions, if you walk in there where their Starbucks is and you go to the left, there's actually a huge recycling bin, and it usually is filled. I actually called and I asked, how often do you have to tip it? And they go, well, actually, it gets filled up in a day, and we actually take it out every day. And I go, that's good. But again, this is representing about 1%. But with education, such as, you know, on your receipts actually saying, bring these bags back, or probably on their monitors when you're actually at the checkout counter, it's saying to bring these bags back. If we raise awareness in that education, we can go from 1% to higher percentages. You know, that's what I actually believe. There is a bill, as I understand it from my from educating myself, that there was Assembly Bill 2449 that took place in 2007. Now, this bill requires all California grocers to take back and recycle plastic bags. This bill also requires retailers to provide consumers with a bag reuse opportunity. Retailers and manufacturers will be required to implement a public education plan, program, and all bags must be labeled, please return to a participating store for recycling. This is what we're already doing. This is a bag that I just showed you. So we are in compliance with the existing laws. We just have to increase the awareness. So going further and beyond that, by mandating in the ordinance that we have, I think goes a little bit further than what we should. Now, if chains like, I'm not going to call out again, like pavilions are concerned with environmental initiatives that they purport to be, you know, why are we not pushing it these processes further in education, letting people know about it? Well, it could be that perhaps that recycling overall is not very conducive to their bottom line. And therefore, if it's not, then why do it? But again, I've actually gone to that particular store and I see us actually complying with that particular bill. Now, what needs to happen in the plastic bag industry, which has been around since the 70s, is advancement in manufacturing research and development. This research and development is best served by funded by a free economy, not government mandates. So as for me bringing my own bag to the store, because people will say, Jenny, you got 22 bags. How come you just can't go out and get a recyclable bag and take it each time? Well, sure, I can do that. And at times, guess what? I already do that. I'm already a steward. And I did it without the government telling me to do so. I'll give you another quick scenario. I went to a coffee place recently, and the lady took my cupcake, which I probably should have had, put it in a nice little box, and she's about to put it in a bag, and I told her, excuse me, save the environment. I don't need a bag. And you know what? I was rewarded for that behavior by the young man that was down the way. He worked for the store, and he said, thank you. That's what I needed to hear. As a parent, I know I can't force positive behavior. It has to be led and has to be influenced. So the next point that I really want to bring out, and this is really a concern for many, I know that it is for some of the people in my households, are how sanitary are the reusable bags? I know I could be sanitary with my bags, but what about the person in front of me? I don't know where their bag has been or if it has been recently cleaned, as it regularly should be, and this could be a problem. As a mom, I have children. They're bringing home God knows what. I don't need one more thing to contend with on a health issue from someone that possibly intermixed their fruits and vegetables with their meats, had it on their bag, didn't wash it out, then put it on the stoop there where the bags go to package up their goods and have a transference issue. And this is actually not a scare tactic or anything. I actually did read about it. And what they're finding is other bacterias and things like norovirus coming on these bags. So that could be another issue. And I know as a mom, I'm looking at that particular issue. So what are we going to do about that with these bags? So there is an education issue that has to be had with these reusable bags. And where will that come from? I don't know if the ordinance actually addresses that. So in summary, I have concerns about this ordinance, its impact on me as a consumer, the impact on the smaller businesses, and potential health concerns. Should government be in the business of dictating behavior and letting an entity profit from it? In its current form, the city ordinance and that of the pending state legislation should be reconsidered. This is simply, in my opinion, and I'm respectfully disagreeing, this is not the right ordinance for the city at this time. So I'm going to ask for you to please reconsider. I know I was a bit long, but thank you so much for listening to me.
Thank you. Hal Levin.
Good evening. My name is Hal Levins. I live on Crescent Drive in Monrovia. The two prior speakers were so good, I feel like what I have to say is pretty much inadequate. But just some ideas. We just lost Albertsons, and I asked somebody why we lost Albertsons. They said they just weren't making it. And the reason is probably manyfold, but they had to compete with Costco, which is probably 3 or 4 miles away. They had to compete with Target. They had to compete with many other stores. And with narrow margins, they just couldn't make it. Now, the prior speaker said that she chose at times to shop someplace else because it's much more convenient than being in Pasadena with no plastic bags. So we don't want to lose another business of any kind because we have a unilateral ban on plastic bags. If it comes down from above, we may not have any choice. But why we should put any burden on our current businesses, I just don't understand. So I'm speaking against having a unilateral plastic bag in Monrovia. Thank you.
Thank you. Pam Fitzpatrick.
I'm Pam Fitzpatrick, 412 South Myrtle, 310 South Myrtle. So I'm number 4, and I cannot even measure up to Hal and Gina and Ray. I'll tell you, I am so glad whoever pulled this from the consent agenda. Usually these things just get voted on for a second reading, and we don't get another chance. But I don't have a political horse in this race. I am just, as I've always been, a supporter of Old Town since I first moved in here 23 years ago. And all I'm asking is for you to consider that there may be another point of view other than the statistics that staff genuinely in their studies brought to you that seemed reasonable. The statistics that said generally these bags don't harm businesses. They get worried, but they don't harm them. The reason I take objection to that is because of all the years we've been working together, we work and you market Old Town as unique. That's how we work together. We market Old Town as the most unique town center in the San Gabriel Valley or in all the world. We are unique in that we're kind of like a three-legged stool in that we butt up against the foothills, our lovely, beautiful foothills. It gives us three draws, basically, major draws, south, east, and west. And I think that when you looked at the statistics for us, you didn't stop to consider that we are unique. As Ray said, that's how we market ourselves, that's how we look at ourselves. So if we are in fact unique, then look at us as a city of 38,000 plus, centered between right next to Arcadia on the west with a Ralph's, so easy to go to, that will not be covered by our ban. And on the west, Target and Walmart, who not only have groceries, but have toys that I sell, and Notions that 626 sells, and gifts that other people sell, and clothing, and cheaper. Not as good, and not as friendly a people to talk to, and not a great a place. But if you have to go there, then you do one-stop shopping. I'm asking you to please, at the very least, ask staff to go back and find stats that cover the uniqueness of our Old Town. And please stop this from going into effect right now. You're going to really devastate our fourth quarter. Not our restaurants, but our retail. Please don't pass this tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. I have no other speaker cards on this item. Am I seeing one? If there are anybody else who would like to speak, please bring your speaker cards.
I'm your neighbor, Dorothy Kelty.
So we're both neighbors.
I got on the internet today. I understood that the state ban on plastic bags or on non-reusable bags was moving along, and that most likely it will be in effect in September of 2015. So rather than have Monrovia go through all of the machinations to enact their own law, when the state, they're saying the state is going to be the first one in the nation to enact it statewide, and they think the rest of the country will follow. Both reusable plastic bags and paper bags will be 10 cents a piece if a customer doesn't bring in their own bags to pack out the groceries. To go along with what Gina and a couple of other folks have said, I used to like to check the meats at Howe's Market on Huntington Drive in San Gabriel. They had nice quality meats for many years. And I found myself after twice being in there and not having bags, hesitating to go in there. Now, it wasn't a trip my life is very different than it used to be. My life used to, I'd look at the ads once a week on food sales. I'd go out and shop. I'd bring the car home full, cook, and go back out all week. Well, those days are gone, so my marketing days are few and far between. But I found myself not stopping in at Howe's when I was going down San Gabriel Boulevard off of Huntington. And I was really sad the other day because I went to go over there and I found that they had closed. So it really does put you off as far as going into a store when you have other stores within a few miles that do offer bags. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who has a speaker card that please come forward?
Sorry about, I'm Lori Beyer. I live here in Monrovia, and I was on the committee that was appointed to look at the plastic bag issue, where we got a lot of information. My one point is, I'm sorry I was late with the card, but I didn't know that we were doing public comments. I'm learning how this works. So my concern, one, is a little confusion here. I thought the item was pulled, but we're still talking about it. So I would encourage, if it was pulled because the whole council isn't here, I would like to encourage us to stick with that and vote when the whole council's here. The other is that, you know, the committee did a lot of work. We had a lot of research. They voted to approve an ordinance. The council voted and approved that. One of the things that I am concerned about is I'm hearing a lot of fear. And I'm hearing some information that isn't actually part of the ordinance in terms of the folks here in the stores in Old Town. So I think it would be important to go back and revisit the data, the factual information, the surveys, and really look at what we proposed, what the committee recommended. We did a lot of work on this. And I'm hearing a lot of fear, and it's based on information that really isn't part of the ordinance, doesn't cover these businesses, and I would like us to go back and kind of relook at that, remind ourselves that it's not covering the smaller shops here in Old Town, and to also encourage whatever process we're doing now is to go back, if this item was pulled, to pull it and then go back to it and revisit that. That would just my suggestion at this point. We're kind of confused of what's, if we're voting this, I'm not voting this, or we're pulling it. So there's a little confusion here. So I would just recommend that we stay with if it was pulled and then meet on it on another time. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other speaker cards or speakers? Okay, I guess we should clarify. The item was pulled, and we had pulled it to put on the agenda next month, but we had speakers who wanted to speak at our next meeting. But we had speakers who wanted to speak on it, which is why we're hearing the speakers at this time.
That was not my understanding.
Can I speak?
Sure.
I wanted to pull it.
Right.
I wanted to pull this item.
But Becky, if you could, and I hate to interrupt, but everybody needs to understand pull means pull it from the consent calendar.
Right.
And put it onto the normal agenda. Not make it go away. Move it to where we can talk about it.
What happened this evening, found out just moments before the city council meeting began, found out that Alex Blackburn would not be here. This was never meant to be a gotcha moment or any kind of underhanded move on my part. I don't think it's any surprise. I've been against this ban. And it's because I'm against a ban in general. I don't believe for a moment that it does what we want it to do. We have a litter problem, a horrendous litter problem. And the United States spends billions of dollars cleaning up litter. And we only have ourselves to look at regarding that. If we all did the right thing, I know that sounds very simple, but if we all did the right thing, we wouldn't have the problems we have. We wouldn't be purchasing storm drain filters to catch all that garbage that's there if we'd only pick up after ourselves. In terms of the plastic bags, this is a very small waste stream, and it's true. It would only affect certain businesses. However, most people, once they find out there's a ban, I don't think they get out a piece of paper and say, oh, well, which ones do and which ones don't. They just know Monrovia doesn't have a ban. And if even for a minute, like Gina said, if even for a minute that someone decides, you know, well, I'll just drive, just or I'll stop first, I'll stop in Arcadia, and I'll shop at Ralph's or go on the other way, stop at Ralph's and Duarte, that's business that Monrovia is missing out on. But going back to plastic bags, in the ordinance that's proposed, it defines the term reusable bag. And I've heard it said and also written that what this legislation is before the state is really not about banning plastic bags. It's just regulating the manufacture and distribution of plastic bags. So under our ordinance, it talks about the term reusable bag, and it goes through all these different things, and it has a minimum lifetime of 125 uses, refers to the capability of carrying a minimum of 22 pounds, and over a distance of at least 175 feet, that's interesting, has a minimum volume of 15 liters, and it goes on and it says, and then if made of plastic, is a minimum of at least 2.25 mils thick. You're talking about just a thicker plastic bag. The state ban will regulate that. They'll certify that the plastic used has a certain recyclable content. So that's really about the only difference, and there's also some incentives that might be paid to manufacturers. Although ours also says, use of reusable bags, all stores must provide reusable bags to customers, either for sale or at no charge. So one of those thicker plastic bags, you could give it out for free, or you could sell it. It doesn't say the amount. In the state one, it says that they can't be, or that it's a charge of not less than 10 cents per bag. But in either case, we're not getting rid of plastic. And Gina, you couldn't have said it better. And there have been others, and Ray, and I've said it from up here. It's about education. We need to educate ourselves and others. I'm all against litter. We have a problem. But I don't believe banning a bag gets us there. And I find it very interesting, people that don't normally say boo to me or ever complain, they said, you know, I don't complain, but I have to tell you, this really gets to me. I'm so emotional about this. Don't do it. Don't let it happen. And they're mad. They're mad. And if we're trying to change a mindset, do we want people to do it because they're forced to and we want to tick them off and send them elsewhere? Or even if they're here, do we want them to be grumpy shoppers in Monrovia? No. It just doesn't get us where we want. I know that the people that are for this and everybody, I know there have been some nasty names bandied about up here that if you're not for this, you're stupid and you're lazy and whatever. These people that have come before us, they're not lazy and they're not stupid. And they don't like trash. They just want people to be educated, and we want to do it because it's the right thing to do, not because the government told us that we have to do it. We are unique, and we can do it. There's no reason that a government should have to tell us that you can't use a bag when at the same time they're going to manufacture more bags, and we can still buy bags, lots of plastic bags, and put them into the waste stream. We need to tackle it at a whole different level because we know it's right. We are Monrovians, and we can be different. We don't need to create ourselves as an island. And I think it's been pretty much bandied about and said both ways. My heart goes out to those who really want to clean up a mess, but I just don't think this is the way to do it.
I think it's important that everyone understands the process. And there's a reason every law that we create has to be voted on twice. And they call it the second reading, and they do that so that we don't sneak laws on people in the middle of the night without them knowing. And during this past 2 weeks, in between the first voting and what tonight would be the second voting, every single person I've met about this has been against it. Every single one. I've not had one person call me up or show up at my office or meet me anywhere saying, gee, Tom, that was great. People are pretty upset about it. I think I would agree that the state of California is probably going to do this, and at that point it probably makes some sense. And I would actually like to make a motion that we not adopt Ordinance 2014-02.
Go ahead, Marianne.
I was just waiting to see if there was a second.
Like I said, before the meeting, and excuse me, I'm not feeling too hot tonight. Before the meeting, I was not planning on, like I said, this is not to pull a fast one on anybody. But Mr. Blackburn is not here. I don't think the mindsets of everybody that sit up here are going to be any different 2 weeks from now. Gina, you really said some very powerful things and really nailed it. I'm going to second the motion to not pass it.
For discussion, first off, while my colleagues are saying they've had nothing but people come to them opposing this ban, I have to tell them that I've had nothing but people thanking me for this. I have had emails and phone calls and numerous amount of residents tell me that they are so grateful that we are doing this and we are protecting our environment and we are following our environmental accords. So this is a discussion that has a balanced amount of people on both sides. I must say there are as an equal amount of people. Now, did the people who come here tonight, were they orchestrated to come and come on a, I believe they were. And I appreciate their comments, many of whom we have had comments from in the past. However, I don't believe that the people who have been supportive of this issue had any idea that this was going to be a situation where they should felt that they needed to come and make comments. I also feel as Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin says, you know, she didn't mean this to be a gotcha, but, you know, we had five members of this body make a decision, an important decision in this city. And I truly believe that if we're going to revisit this, even on a second reading, which is a normal process to do, that we should do this with the same amount of council members present as we had with our full discussion. Whether you meant it to be a gotcha or not, it sure is. And I greatly oppose this motion. I would emphatically request that we do not vote on this motion tonight. In fact, I will make a substitute motion that we do not take a vote on this tonight and that we re-agendize this item for the next council meeting where we have all five members who had discussed and gone over this item several meetings in the past. That is only the right thing to do.
I don't accept that, and I would call the question on the first motion.
All right, then we will have a roll call vote.
Councilmember Adams?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin?
The motion is to not adopt the ordinance.
And for clarification, I'm going to vote to turn it down, to not support the ordinance.
And Mayor Lutz?
The motion was to not support the ordinance. I vote to support the ordinance, so I guess my motion is, my response is no.
Motion carries.
So I believe and that carries?
I have to tell you, I've never felt like this has been an orchestrated political game before, but it sure feels like it this evening. We will now take up the item of public opinion and public comment. This is the time for any member of our community who wishes to speak to this council about any item that is not on the agenda may come forward. Our city clerk will call your name.
Gwendolyn James.
Well, Monrovia, I have some good news tonight. I'm standing here representing the Quota International Club, Monrovia Duarte. And we have some good news. We want to talk about our annual fundraiser. This is not a typical fundraiser invitation, but we extend it to everybody in Monrovia. Get with me and enjoy us for fun. It's about great fun, new and old friendships and relationships, possible great fortunes beyond your wildest dream. And I want you to think about that. That could be you. You might ask, what cornucopia is she talking about? The annual Quota Club beautiful trip to Pechanga Casino in Temecula, California. Oh, when is this trip coming? Soon! Saturday, June 14th. Kick back. Get on our luxurious coast. Take it to High Horizons, the coach of the foothills. We'll be departing at 8 o'clock in the morning that Saturday, June 14th, from the Monrovia Park and Ride. And while you're on that trip, and we're going on this scenic ride, we have available on the coach free prizes, adult refreshments. That doesn't mean ladies jumping out of hats either. All of this will be in little cups. Bingo with cash payoffs. And when we reach Pechanga, and this is a place that has a Las Vegas-type touch, there's gaming and casinos, incredible buffets and restaurants. And for non-gamblers like myself, come along, because they have awesome swimming pools, in great places to sit and read books, in lots of stores and shopping. And you say, well, what is it all about? It's just a modest cost of $25. And that includes the continental breakfast, $10 food credit for new players. And Quota has a commitment to Monrovia. We commit with every dollar that you give us. As we pick up the funds from the trip, we commit 100% of the funds that are raised. We commit toward the local Monrovia community needs. We commit this money to student scholarships in the Monrovia Duarte area. We commit money for programs for deaf and the hard of hearing. And we commit the money for abused women and children. This is our commitment to you, Monrovia. So we say, help us and commit to us. Help us do this. We need you to sign up quickly, because on our last two trips, there just weren't any seats. Please save the date, Saturday, June 14th. Meet us at 8 o'clock at the Monrovia Park and Ride and get on that coach. And we're going to have a great trip to Pechanga. We have put on a second stop since this trip has been such a good thing for the community. And we will be picking up persons in the city of San Dimas. So help us with this cause. We have flyers here at City Hall. But if you're still using your phones to communicate, please call Linda Proctor at area code 626-255-3833 or email her at Linda, L-I-N-D-A dot B, like boy dot Proctor, P-R-O-C-T-O-R, at gmail.com. And if you want to mail checks, Mail them to her address at 201 North Sunset Place, Monrovia, 91016. Can we commit? Yes, we can, Monrovia. Help the club. Help the students. Help abused women and children. Help those people that are hard of hearing. Help people that need scholarships for college. And just help our town. Quota is asking for your help. Thank you for the space.
Thank you. There are no other speaker cards. Please bring up speaker cards if you have speaker cards, everyone. I believe Dorothy just said she had a speaker card. I don't have any of them now.
You must have noticed. You must have noticed all the activity in the park Saturday and Sunday. It was really great. It was Monrovia's birthday, and two Old Town merchants stepped up to the plate. Thank you so much to Keely Milliken from Center Stage for Saturday, and to Studio C for the Sunday Music Festival. They were wonderful. There were booths in the park. There was music. There was kids' fun. There were people all over Old Town. And from the bottom of my heart, representing the Old Town merchants in my part of Monrovia, I just want to thank Center Stage and Studio C. You know what? When things change and one entity can't do it, well, somebody else fills in for a little while and we just help each other out. So that's what happened this weekend, and thank you for those two Old Town merchants for stepping up to the plate. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dorothy Kelsey.
Good evening again. I feel compelled to answer some of the things that the city attorney said following my testimony at the last meeting regarding the eminent domain threat by the city to two property owners to get access to the Wilderness Preserve. I'd like to know what action the city took in public to decide to declare eminent domain or to have the option to declare eminent domain on this property. I heard the city attorney say, well, it's in the Cloverleaf specific plan for residential development, it's in the Madison Avenue plan for residential development, and you know what? The Miller property is not part of the Madison specific plan for residential development. The minute the city purchased it with a state grant and with our money and with the state grant and put it into Wilderness Preserve. Those two specific plans are for residential development. Now the Robinson property that's currently for sale does fall under the Cloverleaf specific plan for residential development. The city letter that went to our two residents says that they need access across this property for recreation and emergency vehicle access. Then the recreation is listed for the Hillside Recreation Area in the city of Monrovia. What that means is that you're telling these property owners you need access through their property on Cloverleaf to get to Canyon Park and Trask Boy Scout Camp or to Arcadia Wilderness Park, because those are the hillside recreation areas. That really seems kind of bogus. I really think it's awful what you're doing when you have 2 points of egress into that property within a quarter to a half a mile of what is there now, what is the private driveway of these two citizens. You have two signs up, Hillside Wilderness Preserve. one on the reservoir property at the south side of Tyler Bayes's. I tried to get into the Hope Wilderness Preserve from that property. I tried to find the trail. I went clear to the end of it, to the west side, and then I went north into the Wilderness Preserve until I was turned away by the hills and the tangles. If this is where you expect people to get into the Wilderness Preserve, you better mark that trail and let them go in. I don't know what you have a sign for on city property right next to Tyler Bayes's saying Wilderness Preserve. The other sign you have is on Hidden Valley, the west spur of Hidden Valley. You go up there, the city clearly owns property between two residences. For about 40 feet, there's a trail. And then you have to take a machete or climb like a mountain goat to get up into the Wilderness Preserve. You need to clear, cut out what's growing in sort of a seasonal stream bed there so people can walk into the meadow there. Or you need to provide a safe way for them to go up on the ridge. When I came down from the ridge, I had to sit down and slide on the seat of my pants to get down safely. But I had my cell phone with me because I thought I may have to call 911. You have access into the Wilderness Preserve in that area without declaring eminent domain on people's private property. There was no action that I'm aware of taken in public to say you were going to do this. This means to me, as a property owner in this community, you can decide one day to send me a letter and you decide it's a shortcut to get over to Mayflower. You want to make Highland a shorter block. This is a horrible precedent to be setting. You don't need this access to get into Canyon Park. Now, I understand Glenn Owens says he's hiked this for years. But the truth of it is the nursery has kept that property locked since the 1920s. That what we call the caretaker's cottage is actually the gatekeeper's cottage. And once Gary Miller bought that property, he had an armed person in there to prevent people from going through. So as far as a prescriptive easement in that this has always been used for generations by the community, this is bogus. Why put the city through another costly lawsuit by doing that? Spend your money and your time and your energy developing two very nice ways in that match the signs you already have up. Please rethink this. This is a terrible way to treat the citizens in your community. And Fran DeLatch characterized my comments as reflecting poorly on the council. I do think it reflects poorly on you. And I think the fact that this was done when we had an interim community services manager and an interim city manager outside of the public spotlight speaks volumes. Please rethink it. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak to this council on any item that is not currently on this agenda? Please come forward.
All right. Good evening, Mayor and City Council members. We would like to talk about a new type of composting.
Could you give us your name for the records, please?
I am Aries Torres.
Loncolo Bradley.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. And we are from the Monrovia High School. We want to start a project, an environmental project, on food waste removal. A new type of removal that's environmentally friendly, using a type of composting with black soldier fly larvae. And basically what it is you create like a compost in, let's say, a person's house, and those larvae will eat any food waste, such as like chicken, vegetable matter, anything like that, and then we'll turn it into compost. And that compost can be used for gardens or anything. And this is a completely environmentally friendly, since you're just using larvae, and it's a, you know, just like a better way to remove waste. Also, these larvae can be fed off to wildlife or even pets or anything. They're very nutritious and just good in general.
And here's some stats. On average, one adult male, he'll eat to about 1,460 pounds of food a year. And each person, on average, wastes about a third of all the food they eat a year. So with that stat, the average male, one male, will waste to about 481 pounds of food waste a year. And through the use of the black soldier fly larva, the larva will be able to take about 5% of all food waste and convert it into compost. So through that, they'll be able to, from 481 pounds of food waste, they'll be able to create 24 pounds of compost. Now with me, I have a large family, so I have three males in the household, my mother as well as my baby brother. So with that, we'll actually eat all together of about 7,300 pounds of food a year, and which means that we'll waste about 2,400 pounds. So that's well over a ton. So with the black soldier fly larva, it'll be able to create into our organic compost, and it'll be able to create about 120 pounds of compost, which could be replanted back into our gardens, our lawns, and it can also be sold by Athens to local gardening companies, as well as Home Depot to be able to make a profit. So these black soldier fly larvae are environmentally friendly. They're not pests. They actually thrive on weather outside of the home. So you keep these flies outside the home. Due to sheer size, they'll actually prevent the coming in of the common house fly. And because once they mature and they become actual fly, they do not have mouth parts, so they're not able to actually eat our food, so they'll not become pests in the household, and they won't come into our household and eat the food. And like how common house flies, they carry many diseases because they land on feces and other type of disease-ridden materials. Unlike these flies, because they like the outside wilderness, they typically don't go into households, and they just aren't pests to family members or people. So it's just a more environmentally friendly way of creating an organic compost, and being able to save money by recycling the food waste that the average human wastes a year.
So, all right, so in conclusion, we'd like to create a program to create awareness of this type of composting and potentially make like Monrovia, like as a whole, if everyone started doing this, it would reduce our food waste, and like we'd be kind of like a revolutionary city in a way that how we manage our food waste. And also it just helps in the environment a lot help too. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to speak to this council about any item that is not on our agenda? Seeing and hearing none, we will close that portion of the agenda. And to our young men with your composting idea, touche, great job. What I'd like you to do is, we have our public works director somewhere in the building who will find you. He's in the back foyer. We have a composting program that our public works department has been working with, but I'd like you to have some conversation with them about your new idea. So he will be coming to the counter, and you can have some conversation with him about that. Thank you very much for the idea. And he's walking to the door right now. also, Mr. Steele, could you please comment for us regarding Ms. Kelty's comments?
Sure, Mayor. As I said last week, this council has taken no action to formally impose an eminent domain acquisition of the easement. The process set out by California law is very specific and has a number of steps to it. We are in the midst of a very, very preliminary stage of that process. It was not, in fact, any action taken under an interim city manager or an interim community services director. This process has been in a planning stage for a couple of years, and so was not as Ms. Kelty characterized it. In addition, the environmental impact report that this city council certified for the management plan very clearly stated that one use of the environmental impact report was to support the potential acquisition of trails or entrances to the preserve or to the recreation area. So that was a very public, very formal action taken a few years ago now as part of the environmental impact report. It very specifically states that in the report. So again, the we are at a very preliminary stage of a process that is set out by California law. Property owners are being treated fairly and with a great deal of respect. And if, in fact, it is proposed that the city acquire a very small easement across a driveway, that will be done in a private, in a public process, not a private setting. There will be a public hearing, which will be noticed, and everybody will have the opportunity to comment on that, if in fact that is a action that is proposed to the city council. But we are not anywhere near that stage at the moment.
Thank you. We'll move on now to our reports of city manager and staff. We'll start with Mr. Sizemore.
Yes, at the May 6th city council meeting, the council directed staff to prepare a letter to not include Monrovia in the National Recreation Area. The letter was sent out, and we're putting it back on the agenda tonight to get direction on the scope of the letter and if that was a sufficient response from the city. So what staff is looking for is direction from the council on the letter and to hear any comments that you may have on it.
I did have a concern. I understand we asked that we said we wanted to opt out. And there's been some conversation since that letter indicating that even though that we have said we want to opt out, that it's ultimately Congresswoman Chu that will make that decision. We can't unilaterally say we want to opt out. And how would we confirm that we were able to get out of the NRA?
We would have to research it, look into it, find out if that's the case. If it's National Recreation Area and the federal lands, then we may not have as much say-so on the matter, even though they might be in the jurisdiction of Monrovia. But that would have to, I would have to look into that and find out what the direct aspects of that are.
So the fact that we said we want to opt out does not mean we get to opt out. That would ultimately be her decision whether or not we were included or not.
Well, she did say she would support local control. Mm-hmm. And I think anybody who tells you they support local control would honor that. I had an even bigger concern, and although I never got a copy of the letter, I did have it read to me. And what was read to me seemed to kind of almost dumb down what the council did. Mm-hmm. It talked more about the Wilderness Preserve and really not about the community. And the big concern I have about that is that when we make a motion up here and we vote on that, I think it's something that we need to know is taken care of. But more importantly, the people at home who see us make motions and vote on those things need to completely understand that the will of this council is taken care of seriously. And I don't think that was done on this letter. To a second point, I was a little concerned that a letter to a high-ranking elected official was not signed by any of our elected officials. And I think the most important letters between government agencies are signed by electeds, not by interim staff members who are no longer with us. So I actually drafted a letter that I thought might be more appropriate, and I brought it with me this evening, and I'd like to read it to everyone. And it's addressed to the Honorable Judy Chu regarding the National Recreation Area. On May 6, 2014, the Monrovia City Council voted unanimously to exclude any properties within the city of Monrovia from the San Gabriel Mountains National Recreation Area. Although we do understand that other cities may see value in being included, we do not. Our wilderness area is well established and needs no assistance from the federal government, and our business community via the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce previously voted to not be included in the area. We thank you for allowing those of us who are of like mind to opt out of the pending legislation. And the promise I was given by Congresswoman Chu is that she would respect local control. And I would hope that if this passes this evening and the five of us sign this and send this to the Congresswoman, that she would honor her word. And I would move that we send this letter.
I think that that's much closer than what was sent on the 7th. I also have a problem with the original letter that somehow intimated that we might be supporting the NRA. We took no position. And since that time, I also had a question for both Mr. Sizemore and Mr. Steele regarding access, just as we want access to our wilderness preserve. Our Canyon Park has a road that accesses or provides access up to national forest lands. Now, I'm not asking you to answer this question right now, but I had posed that, and I just wanted to ask because I don't know what the answer is there. Are there access issues? If we've opted out and we're not included, but then we have to provide access for a national recreation area because that road has been used for access to the national forest. Just a question.
I think I can speak to part of what you're talking about, but I think it's even more than a road. There are portions of Canyon Park which are actually Angeles Forest. They're not the city of Monrovia property. And so I think that may be that question, I think, mm-hmm. pertains more to just a road that goes through. If I'm correct, portions of the area by the falls are actually Angeles Forest. And so I think that we might want to look more carefully at that, if in fact that is the request that we've asked of Judy Crew too, which was our request. With regard to the letter that Mr. Adams is presenting, I don't necessarily have issue with the letter, but what I think we may want to do, to be more precise, if we are truly concerned about the motion, how it was made, and what it was said, I'd like to get a transcript of what the motion, how it was made, and what it was said prior to us sending another letter, so that we are completely accurate with what we voted on and what was voiced in the motion and what was voted on, so that we're not back and forth, sending back and forth, but we have one clear clarifying letter that states, based on the factual record that we have from our council.
Well, the motion I made that evening was to have the city of Monrovia excluded from the National Recreation Area. Not the Monrovia Wilderness Preserve, but the city of Monrovia, which includes everything.
And I would just like clarification by the actual record, so that what we do write has 100% record verification. If we're concerned about the letter having the actual verbiage, then let's get the actual verbiage.
There's also the opportunity in one of my items under my report regarding a letter, and we might be able to address both things under that. We don't want to be writing a whole bunch of letters, but I don't think that the letter that went out on the 7th accurately depicted what
I do think they're separate issues, because there are the wilderness designation, there's the wild and scenic rivers, there's letters to the COG, but this was very specific, and I think the motion was very clear that Monrovia be excluded from the National Recreation Area, and my motion is tonight is to follow up with this letter, and I believe we have a second.
Did you actually second it?
Well, I didn't second it. I would say a follow-up letter or some kind of revised letter that all of us sign. I don't necessarily say that specific letter, but a redo of the letter. And then also ask, I'd like to know, when are we going to get a response? How are we going to know, are we in, we out? She acknowledges it. We ask that she acknowledge our withdrawal from the NRA. And with that,
so I'm not hearing a second of Mr. Adams's motion.
I guess I'm asking him to amend it. We can clarify through transcripts what was actually passed, the motion that was made. But in addition to that, I would like some additional verbiage that we're going to get some kind of a response confirming yay, nay, or we'll let you know.
Well, you can add a request for a response in here. I don't know that there's any requirement that anyone do respond to us. But I think this letter is abundantly clear, and I think it is right in line with what the motion was 2 weeks ago.
So her request for you to amend the motion
is denied.
I at this point, I do not have a second. So the motion will die at this point. I would recommend that and ask that at my report next month, that this be added and that we have a transcript request, that we have a transcript of the motion so we can discuss the verbiage of the letter and use that kind of information that has quotes from the motion that was made. And also, I agree with Ms. Shevlin. Let's talk about what kind of a response we would request from the Congresswoman. It's my understanding that this is the bill is in a draft form right now, and that she's taking comments, or the comment period has been closed, but the bill will be recirculated, taking in the comments. So my assumption is that the response will come to us when the bill is come back in its final. But even as we all know with legislation, the final isn't necessarily the final either. She's the author. She can alter and change the bill at any point that she wishes to, all down the line. So that I would ask that we put that on my...
And can we just clarify how much of a transcript you want?
I think...
Because you did approve minutes that have the language of the motion there. Do you want the entire discussion, or do you want...
Let's see if this is enough of a specific...
It's on page 5 of the minutes.
What we have before us is it was moved by Councilmember Adams, seconded by Councilmember Shevlin, to direct staff to draft a letter to Congresswoman Chu opposing inclusion of Monrovia in the National Recreation Area boundaries. In my opinion, that's more vague than I think what we're looking for here. So I would ask that we...
Monrovia boundaries is vague to you? That's funny. We have a legal map that tells you what the Monrovia boundaries
are.
That shouldn't be vague to
Mr.
anybody.
Mr. Adams, you...
In fact, there shouldn't be anybody up here that thinks that the definition of Monrovia is vague.
I'm not speaking to that part,
Mr.
Adams. I'm speaking to the part where you quoted what you said the motion was, and that's not the quote that's written here. That's why I'm saying... It's not connecting. Let's get the actual transcript.
Well, we got it right here. So what page is that on, Mr. Steele?
It's on page 5 of the minutes that were...
That's what I just read.
She just read.
Yeah, I'm trying to find it.
It's the first bold paragraph on page 5.
I'm getting there.
It seems to me that the letter, the wording in the letter is what needs to be resolved. I think in looking at the letter, and I think you have a copy on there, it states in the top in the subject matter, natural recreation, do not include Monrovia. That's very specific. The language is maybe is not as strong as you want it to be.
Well, since these are the approved minutes, mm-hmm. Let's just take it straight from the minutes. That staff was directed to draft a letter to Congresswoman Chu opposing inclusion of Monrovia in the National Recreation Area.
I was concerned because the way the letter also was written, it made reference to the Wilderness Preserve, but did not Canyon Park, although mm-hmm. it followed up and said properties in Monrovia, but it sounded like we were only talking about the Wilderness Preserve, saying that to remove all properties in, what did it say again?
Well, the motion was to oppose the inclusion of Monrovia in the National Recreation Area.
Right.
It was not to oppose the inclusion of the Wilderness Preserve,
right.
as the letter stated.
Right.
It was opposing the inclusion of Monrovia.
Correct.
So I would ask that letter be changed to state exactly what the motion said and to have that signed by the council and forwarded on to the Congress.
And I would ask that the correct, except I believe we should have the transcript to get the record, the actual verbiage.
Well, you just approved this, so these are the approved minutes of the meeting.
I certainly did, but it's not a verbatim transcript, and I'm asking for a verbatim transcript. There are two different things of the record. At any point, unless we're going to rewrite the motion, the letter at this junction, which I don't think we're going to.
That's what my motion was to
rewrite
the letter.
That was right. Not. Are you saying what you just said was a motion?
Yes.
I did not realize that was a motion.
Yes.
I would recommend an amendment that we rewrite the motion using the verbatim transcript of the council meeting verbiage, and that we add the information that Ms. Shevlin is interested in, which is how we would receive confirmation from the Congresswoman. I would ask that as an amendment.
I'm fine with asking the Congresswoman to reply to us. These are the approved minutes, and unless you want to strike these, I don't know that we should go tinker with them.
I'm not tinkering with them. I'm asking for a verbatim of the transcript, which are two different things. One is the official record of the transcript, and the other is our minutes. They're two different things.
I'd rather deal with the official minutes of the city of Monrovia.
I'll try to mediate this here. Obviously, if we have a transcript that has it verbatim what we said, no one can ever argue then. I know we accepted these minutes, but if we have the actual verbatim motion, nobody's going to argue with what that is, and I would then, let me see, we're getting really...
Well, here's, we have a motion. First, we need to see if there is a second on Mr. Adams's motion, and I've asked for an amendment. He's not concurring to the amendment, so we need to see if there's a second first before we do anything else.
I would only second if amended. But I can't, okay. I guess.
So we do not have a second on the motion.
Well, amended how, Becky?
Just said that it says whatever the transcript says in our motion, the motion that was made by you, seconded by me, whatever that motion says, to include that actual verbiage in the letter and ask in the letter that she please respond as to how she will acknowledge that.
Okay. I need to first clear up. We do not have a second, and the motion will go no further. Becky, would you like to make a motion at this time?
I'll make a motion that we redraft the letter to include the actual motion that was made on May 6th, and that
verbatim
transcript records, and that we include the additional verbiage requesting that she confirm, how do we say this, She acknowledged
that we receive a response from her via our request.
That's good.
I'll second that motion. Any further discussion?
I just think it's interesting that we voted to adopt these as the official records of the city of Monrovia, but they're not good enough to write a letter. Seems kind of fascinating to me, but go ahead.
Well, I think it's an acknowledgement that an official recording and transcript are the actual official record
I think actually the minutes that we adopt are the official records.
Do you want? Would you like, as part of the official transcripts, would you like to see a draft letter also?
Yes, please.
And signed by the council members.
Yeah. Okay, so we'll submit the verbatim to on the motion.
Agenda. When it comes back on the agenda in 2 weeks, we'll present a draft letter.
With a draft letter on it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. We have a roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Adams?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Shadman?
Yes.
Mayor Lutz?
Yes. Okay, anything else, Mr. Sizemore?
No.
Okay. Next, we'll go to items of council, and we'll begin with Mr. Adams.
I actually have one thing I put on this evening, and it's actually a request from County Supervisor Mike Antonovich. It's a letter that he forwarded to the Chamber of Commerce asking for support for AB 2534, which is a bill that would allow the County of Los Angeles to contract with private jails. Give everybody a little history on this. Federal courts ordered that the states reduce their state prison population, and the governor's solution, AB 109, was to transfer inmates from the state prison system into the county jail system. Unfortunately, only sent, I'm told, half as much money as is required to house those inmates, causing the counties to release prisoners early back out on the street, which has created a lot of havoc. LA County attempted to contract with another county for the transfer of prisoners, and were told that LA County was threatened with a lawsuit by the governor's office if they continued on in that line. So this law would simply allow the County of Los Angeles to contract with private jails to have people serve a little more of their time than they currently are. The supervisor shows four examples in his letter. One, and I was just shocked when I read this, sex crimes against children, the average sentence actually served is 20 days in jail. Molesting children, the average sentence served is 143 days in jail. Kidnapping and robbery. Remember, we were all told that these would be nonviolent criminals that are released. Kidnapping and robbery, the actual sentence served 62 days in jail. I don't know anyone that thinks that people who commit sex crimes against children should serve less than 3 weeks in jail, but that's the reality in LA County. I think this bill deserves our support. Supervisor Antonovich has asked that we send a letter of support to Assemblymember Matthew, and I will pronounce this wrong, DeBabne, and copy his office, and I would so move.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
Anything else?
And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Shevlin.
I'll try something lighthearted here. May 28th, and that is a Wednesday. It's going to be a kickoff citywide of the Community Home Energy Retrofit Project, and that will be held at the Library Community Room here at our library, and that will be from 6:30 to 8. Come out, and that will be a rollout, and there will be great information on how you can retrofit your home to get the maximum in energy savings and comfort. It's about comfort as well, even more so than saving energy dollars, but that's always important too. But so come out and hear how you might be able to retrofit your home on Wednesday, May 28th. Actually, they don't tell you how to do it. They set you up with the right programs and the right contractors. So come out and learn more about that on May 28th. Normally, Mr. Keene is here. He was here for our salute to service at 7 p.m. And we had, I think, was it 4 or 5? We had 5 young servicemen and women that were acknowledged this evening, which was great, and we support them and their families. But at any rate, Chuck normally is here to give us the latest and greatest on a lot of veterans' events. And I just wanted to highlight then the 2 Memorial Day events that are coming up on this Saturday, the 24th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at San Anita Park. That's the county park, and that's Antonovich's honoring our veterans' his annual event, and there will be a special recognition at 11 a.m. that day at the park for our veterans, so come out and support them on that. And then on Monday, Memorial Day, the Allied Veterans Council will be presenting a Memorial Day event at Live Oak Memorial Park at 10 a.m., and that's Monday the 27th. I wanted to also mention that tomorrow I am attending as a liaison to the Foothill Transit Board, the annual governing board meeting, and we will be approving a budget. It's a joint meeting of the annual governing board meeting and executive board meeting. There will also be an election that tomorrow at that meeting. We have a cluster. We've got 6 cities in our cluster. It's Monrovia, Duarte, Arcadia, Temple City, and Bradbury. And I have put my name in the hat to sit on the executive board representing that cluster. And so wish me well tomorrow. They shuttle us off into a little room and we duke it out and somebody comes out the victor. It's not the most flattering process, but that will be tomorrow at 7:45 a.m. And I too wanted to congratulate Keely Milliken for having a great, and also any staff and friends of the Monrovia Library had great book sale and raised lots of good money, and so that's great. I don't think people realize just how much the Friends of the Public Library do to support all of our programming at the library. But Keely did a great job. It was really energized, great pancakes, great entertainment, and kept Monrovia days alive. And then on Sunday, I wasn't able to attend because I was attending the ICSC convention in Las Vegas, but there was a concert in the park as well, and that was a joint partnership between, the Whistling Diva, Carolyn Kaufman, and then the VFW. So I hope that was a great success, too, and happy birthday, Monrovia. And that's all I have. Thank you.
You had some other items.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, now, see, I did the fun stuff first, and so now, okay. Okay, thank you. Just as our last meeting, it was an issue. Congresswoman Chu, in doing her draft legislation, she did put them in 3 pieces, and the National Recreation Area had a deadline for public input on the 30th of April. Well, now these 2, unless something's changed tonight, I don't know, the 2 remaining pieces of legislation, the Wild and Scenic Rivers and the Wilderness Designation portions, those have deadlines for public input on May 30th. Those 2, and correct me if I'm wrong here, Marianne, those 2 will be going before the San Gabriel Valley COG, and don't want to get us in the same situation.
Well, I will tell you that at this point, they are not scheduled to go before the COG. I did check with the executive director of the COG, and they have decided that there needs to be more education, and they're having trouble scheduling educated people on these items, and so they do not have a date to bring it before the COG and don't know if it will at any point ever go before the COG at this point.
And I don't want to overburden staff with this because it is highly, highly technical information, but I would, the second one was request that the acting city manager send a letter to Congresswoman Chu and the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments asking that they take no action on remaining federal legislation until after the affected cities review and take a position. And I would say that definitely do that.
Would you want that for council, the council signed from the council?
I think so.
Sure.
Okay.
And that could be circulated with the...
We'll have you take a look at it before we send it out.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. All right. Yeah, because I don't want staff to, if the COG's not even investigating it at this time.
At this point, the word I got was they're not at this point.
Mm-hmm. It's highly technical. Just want to make sure that Monrovia is not going to be affected, or if our close neighbors are going to be affected, or for the region. I mean, we're not a standalone here. If the region is going to be negatively impacted, that we should know about that, and that the COG not take any action until...
And that Monrovia's voice is Monrovia's voice.
Right, right. So, thank you.
Is there any objection to that order? Then that will be the order for the letter. Anything else?
No.
Okay. For my report, first, I will say there's been a lot of discussion about the events over the weekend, and I won't repeat the events for Saturday, but Sunday's events, Ms. Shevlin wasn't there, and so let me fill in for Sunday's events for the music festival. Caroline Kaufman, most of us know her as the Whistling Diva, has award-winning Whistling Diva, by the way, has had an idea to bring back some music and some live energy into Monrovia Days, so that it was a two-day event like it had been in years in the past. And she put together an amazing group of musicians that played all different kinds of music. Started out with big band era, went to reggae, and there was some punk music. I mean, she filled the gamut with different musicians. It was fabulous. Wonderful booths of people selling all kinds of wares on Sunday, and had a very, very nice turnout. It was a nice event in the park, and there were a lot of comments from the people that were there that this is, you know, this is a real kind of family Monrovia day. So I want to congratulate Caroline Kaufman and her entire team for doing an amazing job of putting things together. She said this is year one. We'll see what she's got up her sleeve for year two. So we'll see how she can wrangle together some Monrovia Day events next year. I'm looking forward to seeing that. And then second, I would just like to wish you well tomorrow at your meeting at Foothill Transit, and if they know what's good for them, you will be voted the chairperson. And we are definitely supporting you in this. I won't be the chair of
the executive board, but to just get a place on the executive board. So representing Cluster 3. We are Cluster 3.
Cluster 3 representative. Is that
yes.
a better way to place
uh-huh.
it? Well, if they know what's good for them, you will be voted that. And we support you in that.
Thank you.
Definitely have earned the position from your work there. And definitely want to, if you're listening out there, Cluster people, that's the vote there. This concludes my report this evening.
Can yes. I add one thing? And I mentioned I was attending ICSC.
Yes.
But we had staff. We had our acting city managers, Steve Sizemore, Lauren Vasquez, and then Alexis Bukowski was there, and then council member Larry Spicer was there. We also had Jennifer McLean, who is representing the San Gabriel Valley Economic Partnership. We were all kind of sharing a booth with her, and then Fran DeLash was there also helping demand, do I have this right, the San Gabriel Valley Economic Partnership,
huh?
Yes. So at any rate, it was a great conference, way too much walking, but we had some really great meetings with some developers, and you will be hearing more from that. We just got back this afternoon, so staff will be coming back to us with a report. So thank you.
Thank you. We do not have any other items on our agenda this evening. As we close, we will close in the memory of Luis Quinteros, a longtime Monrovian who is no longer with us, and we wish his family well in this time of mourning. With that, we will adjourn the Monrovia City Council, and we will, in just a moment, take up the Monrovia Successor Agency. And so we will start the Monrovia Successor Agency meeting, and I will ask for a roll call, please.
Yes, Board Member Adams.
Here.
Vice Chairman Shevlin.
Here.
And Chairman Lutz.
Present.
Board Members Blackburn and Spicer are not present.
First item on the agenda is our consent calendar.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That passes. This is a time for public comment for our successor agency. If anybody would like to speak to this body about items regarding the successor agency that are not on the current agenda, you may come forward. Seeing and hearing none, I'm going to close the public comment portion for the successor agency and take up our administrative report, SAAR1. I'm going to get it one of these days.
It's a lot of words, huh? Letters, at least.
Letters, yeah. Yes.
In November 2006, the Redevelopment Agency purchased a property at 820 South Magnolia Avenue as part of the Station Square Transit Village planning area with hopes of potentially relocating some of the businesses at the Hamby Park development there. In 2008, we entered into a deposition development agreement with SEBA for the development of the property with an industrial condominium project. That expired after several years, and in September 2013, staff presented two proposals to the successor agency, and ultimately the board voted to move forward and negotiate a purchase and sales agreement with SEBA. And the thought behind that is they spent a lot of time and energy on the proposal, had the project the city wanted to see. And so we've been working with them, have drafted a purchase and sales agreement, and it's before you on tonight's agenda. A little bit more background in with regards to where we stand with the Department of Finance and the process that we have to follow. This was sent to the the successor agency approved the long-range management plan. It was approved by the Oversight Board, sent up to the Department of Finance. They did revise it a little bit. Came back down to the successor agency, who approved the revised long-range plan on February 18th of 2013, and ultimately on March of 2014, the Department of Finance approved the successor agency's long-range plan. So this agency can now move forward with a purchase and sales agreement. That's what you have before you tonight. One of the areas that is probably impacts the successor agency the most and the city as the beneficiary is that 23.2% of the sales price comes back to the city for use however the city sees fit. In your staff report, you see a table of how the sale is broken into all the different taxing agencies. The city of Monrovia gets $158,000. The Monrovia Unified School District gets $136,000. So a lot of that money on the sales of property will be good use in the community. So staff has recommended approval of the purchase and sales agreement before you. The recommendations and the options available to you are in the staff report. This concludes the staff report. I'll be glad to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions of Mr. Sizemore?
No.
We'll entertain a motion.
I move approval.
Second.
And further discussion? Since this is a sale of a property, I'm going to ask for a roll call vote, please.
Board Member Adams?
Yes.
Minus Fry, Vice Chairman Shevlin. It's yes. The titles that
yes.
I got to
recall.
Yes.
Chairman Lutz. I could just say the name.
Yes.
Right? Thank you.
Thank you. This passes, and this does conclude our meeting for the successor agency redevelopment. Our next successor agency meeting is not scheduled. It will be as needed, but our next city council meeting will be on... Oh my gosh, June 3rd. Sorry, Tuesday, June 3rd in these chambers at 7:30. Thank you very much. We're adjourned.